surgery is a science with the art and principles. The main components of surgery per se are surgical dissection, which involves the removal of the pathology, and suturing and knotting, which essentially deals with the restoring of anatomy and physiology. The word suture is derived from the Latin word suture, which means to sew. Dear friends, imagine yourself to be in a very peripheral and remote place in a clinic, and a small girl comes to you with a cut injury over her forearm or face with profuse bleeding. She needs your help, and you can't deny it, just giving an excuse that you don't know it, or you are not expert, or you are from different specialty. You need to do something. So it's very essential to know this life-saving basic skill of suturing to do the needful. Performing a suturing in a bleeding patient requires a lot of patience, presence of mind, and practice. Practicing with a complete involvement and perfecting it with a disciplined approach will make you a master in a suturing technique. Yes, this video is a preview or a prerequisite for the upcoming surgical skills suture like surgeon session on 24th of October 2021 between 4 to 6 p.m. wherein we shall discuss in a online live interactive demonstration with supervision about surgical hand wash and sterile gloving techniques, and cleaning and draping of wound, local anesthesia administration, and various types of suturing techniques, and suture removal, skin stapling and removal, what are the common mistakes to be avoided while suturing, and some master tips for the techniques. In this video, we shall discuss about the theoretical aspects of surgical suturing. What are the suture materials required? What are the other essentials? What are the principles of suturing, etc.? Yes. It's a famous saying that suturing is the signature of a surgeon. However well you do inside the abdomen, thorax, or the brain, the patient will feel happy only when the scar or the suture is cosmetically appealing. So this is the standard trademark of a surgeon, so it should be really standard one. In today's video, we shall discuss about the important goals of suturing, suture characteristics, suture materials required, what are the principles of suturing, different suturing techniques, how to remove the sutures, possible complications, and some of the alternative to suture. Look at here. The first scar, as we can see, it's healed by primary intention, the small linear scar. The second one is left to heal by itself without any suturing, has formed a very big scar with rad edges. Which one do you like to offer to your patients? Decide. The main goals of a suturing are to oppose the margins and edges of a wound. If you leave it open for healing, it will form a very big scar, and there are chances of infection. And again, there could be bleeding and other things. So in order to maintain hemostasis, to proper wound healing, to avoid wound infection, and of course, for the cosmetically appealing scar, we need to do the suturing. In the market, variety of suture materials are available. As a medical student or a doctor, or as a surgeon, we should know what suture material we require for that particular condition in a situation. According to the source, suture materials can be classified into naturally available, synthetic, and metallic. Natural in the sense They're derived from either plant or animal origin. Synthetic suture materials are made up of polymers of different compounds, and metallic could be of steel, stainless steel, aluminium, gold or silver, etc. According to the structure, the suture materials can be classified into either monofilament or multifilament, depending on the number of strands or the fibers in it. Depending on the fate, suture metal could be either absorbable or non-absorbable. The natural suture metals could be either absorbable or non-absorbable. The most commonly available absorbable natural suture is plain catgut, which absorbs within a week or two. It's made up of submucosa of the sheep's intestine or of any cattle for that matter. The chromic catgut is the catgut along with chromium salt added in it. The non-absorbable natural suture materials are silk, cotton, linen, etc. But in this video, we shall discuss about those things which are currently used in our day-to-day practice and which are available and which are really relevant for all of us. We are not going to go in detail or in depth of each thing. Instead, we will know something important about everything. The synthetic suture materials, the absorbable ones are polyglactin, polyglycolic acid, polyglyconate, polydiaxonone. Non-absorbable ones are polyamide and polypropylene. Yeah, it's very difficult even to pronounce. So there are some popular brands which have become synonymous with these compounds. Those are Bicryl, Dexon, Maxon, PDS, Nylon, Proline. So we can use these names instead for easy remembering and for easy understanding. See, this is how we get the suture materials packed. So many characteristic features are written on that. We will discuss one by one. The other category is the metallic suture material. That is most commonly available is stainless steel wires, which are used for hard surfaces, like after open heart surgery to approximate sternal edges. We use these stainless steels to retain this sternal approximation. Depending on the number of filaments or the strands, the suture materials could be either monofilament or multifilament. Monofilament can be either again absorbable or non-absorbable. The absorbable ones are catgut, chromic catgut, Bicryl, PDS. Non-absorbable ones are the proline and the nylon. Multifilaments are Bicryl, polyglycolic acid, which are absorbable, and silk, cotton are non-absorbable ones. See, this is what I meant by the monofilament and multifilament. See, here we can see a single filament which makes up the suture material, whereas in multifilament, there are number of filaments or strands which are put together to make a suture material. Even the multifilament sutures could be either coated or uncoated, like this. Main differences between monofilament and multifilament suture materials are, the monofilament suture has no capillary action. I mean to say, it doesn't absorb the water content from the tissue and conducts through it. Whereas multifilament has this water absorption capacity and it can conduct through the through or in between the strands of the suture material, and it can swell up. Because it's a single filament and it's smooth, there's less infection chances. But in case of multifilament, in between the strands, there is a potential and a foci for bacteria to lodge and cause infection. Monofilament doesn't show any resistance while passing through the tissue. It's very smooth, whereas multifilament shows some resistance while passing through the tissues. This has higher tensile strength, whereas multifilament has very less tensile strength. And to secure a knot, more number of throws are required in case of monofilament sutures, whereas with two or three throws, a better knot could be secured with multifilament suture materials. See, this is how we get a suture material, and many things are, many information is given over it. So we will discuss what are these one by one. See, this is the packed suture material we get when we open this. It will be like this, what we have seen inside here. The first and foremost thing is the number here written, the US gauge. So it shows, it tells the size of the suture material. Here it is 50. The number could be vary between 2 to 11 0, that is 2 1 1 0 2 0 3 0 4 0 to 11 0. The increase in number is inversely proportional to the size of it. That means to say 11 0 is the smallest one and 2 is the biggest one. Okay, so 10 is bigger than 11 0 and 1 is bigger than 10. Hope it's clear. And second thing important we should know, note here is the needle type. Needle type, it's written here as reverse cutting. Yes, it could be either round body needle, reverse cutting, conventional cutting, tapered end, and so so many. But depending on the requirement, we use different variety of needles that we should know. And third thing is the suture length we should know. Here it's written 18 inches of 45 centimeters. There's a easy way to remember this. It's called Jenkins rule. Jenkins rule. It says the wound to suture length is 1:4. If the wound size is 1 centimeter, the length of suture required to suture the wound is 4 centimeter or more, maybe 6. So if the wound size is 10 centimeter, we may require suture of this length, that is 45 centimeter, to completely cover it. So that's how we order or we take the sutures according to the wound length. Next thing is we should know is what is the suture is made up of. Here it is polyamide, that is nylon. So nylon is a monofilament, synthetic and non-absorbable variety. So it's mainly used for skin suturing and all. That is the these uses where they are occupied, we should be knowing. And next thing is we should be knowing is where to pick up the needle. See here it's shown, this is the needle and this is the continuation with the suture. So where, this is a place to hold the suture, to remove the suture from the packet using this needle holder. Needle holder, we put it, insert that place and hold the needle and take out the needle with the suture materials from that pack. See, this is the overview of numbering of sutures. The 10-0 to 8-0 is mainly used for very microvascular suturing or corneal suturing. The bigger than that are 7-0 to 5-0, used in neural anastomosis, vascular anastomosis, etc. And bigger, still bigger, 4-0 to 3-0 can be used for skin or subcutaneous tissue, bowel anastomosis, bladder closure, etc. 2-0 to 1-0, see 0 and 1-0 are the same, okay? This can be used for abdominal closure, wall closure, or gastrojejunostomy and hernia repair, etc. Still bigger ones like 1, number 1, number 2 can be used for scalp laceration repair or rib retention, maybe to place any cutaneous stents, etc. There are certain color codes for these sutures. So just looking at the suture itself, we can make out what that suture is made up of. Like if it's a yellowish white, then it is plain catgut. If it's brown, it's chromium, so it is chromic catgut. If it's blue, it is most of it's a proline, but the proline mesh is white in color, remember. Black is silk. If it's violet, and then vicryl. The white sutures are made up of cotton. Next, coming to the needle. In needle, we should know the different parts of needle, then the curvature of the needle, and the different sizes of needle. The needle has, it could be either a pointed end, like in a tip. It could be either pointed or it can be blunt. Second, the other end is, what we can see here is swage end. Swage end wherein the suture is fixed by different means. This is the body of the needle. Okay, so And the shape of the needle here is the curved one. This is the most commonly used, curved. It can be either straight needles, curved ones, J-shaped, spatulated. There are so many varieties. But most commonly used in our general surgery is the curved needles. That too, what you can see here in the curved, there are other so many varieties. 1/4 circle, 3/8 circle, half circle, 5/8 circle, etc. Most commonly used are 3/8 or half circles. In the deep places like oral cavity and so, we use 5/8 circle of needle. Yeah, these are the various tips of a needle. It can be either taper point, that means the body is round and then it's tapering into a pointed tip. Okay, or it can be blunt point. See, entire body is also rounded and the tip also blunt. So it can be utilized for places wherein injury should be avoided, like in muscle or in the intestine, etc. Because inside the muscle there can be vessels. If you prick it with a sharp end, it can cause bleeding and hematoma. So in such places, we can use this blunt blunt-tipped needles. Another variety is conventional cutting ones, which are used for piercing the skin or subcutaneous tissue, or reverse cutting, in a better form. It has a stronger and the tip doesn't get blunt so easily. It can be used for skin suturing or even the mucocutaneous, mucoperiosteal suturing, etc. This is about the suture materials and the needles. Next, coming to the basic principles of suturing. First and foremost, yeah, we have removed the suture from the packet. Then how to hold it? How to hold the needle? See, this is I have a suture along with the needle. Now in the right hand, I have a needle holder or needle driver. Now how to hold this? Where to hold? The needle holder and the needle should be perpendicular to each other, and not in the either in the tip or not in the very proximal, but it should be just below the tip. Just inside the tip, we should hold at a place 2/3 distance from the tip end and 1/3 distance from the swage end. In such place, we have to hold perpendicularly. You should not. Some people in some areas we take it in a forward bending way, but usually perpendicular is preferred. And then using the ratchet here in the needle holder, we just lock it. Okay, so we have got a good grip now and good balance over the needle or suture with the needle holder. How to how to hold the needle holders and the forceps, everything we will discuss in the practical session. There's some interesting grips and all there, so we will learn. And next, after holding this, the needle should be pierced the surface in a perpendicular manner or in a 90 degree fashion. Okay, the needle should be perpendicular or 90 degree to the surface. See, if this is the surface, you should go perpendicularly and then use the curvature of the needle to go inside the through the tissue and come out in a perpendicular manner to the surface. See, in the 90 degree it should come out. That's how we put the needle inside and come out. Next, the depth of penetration should be equal on both sides of the incision line. Okay, if the incision line is there in the middle, first we will take the bite on the one side and come out through the middle, and we'll see how much deep it is. And on the other side also, we take at least in the beginning, so that we make sure that the depth on the either side is equal. The tissue should be never closed under tension. Yeah. The main aim of the suturing is approximating the margins and edge, not to strangulate it or tighten so much that it will become ischemic. So just approximation is enough. Okay, if you find it a little loose, then it's okay, but it should not be too tight. And please make sure that when you close the wound, there is no dead space left. So as deep as possible, the how much over the depth of the wound, you should to cover it entirely, so that there is no dead space left to form seroma or any other collection. If it's a very deep wound or complex wound, better to suture it in layers, in the fat layer or the subcutaneous layer. Close it in one layer. After that, you can close the skin in another layer. It's always better. and the knot, after the taking the bite, the knot, whatever you put, it should come on either side of the incision, not over the incision. Okay, see, this is how in the picture we can see. After this is the intermittent suturing, so simple sutures, the suture knot is on the left side of the wound or on the one side. Okay, and the depth is 0.5 centimeter, that's up to the muscle layer. And the space, depending on different areas in the skin, it could be between the two sutures, it could be 1 centimeter. In the gut, it can be 0.3 centimeter. In the vessels, 0.3 centimeter, and in the vessels it can be 1 mm. Okay, 1 mm. And then avoid inversion of the wound edge. After closing the wound, after putting the sutures, sometimes the margins could be inverted inside like this. That will retard the healing. So always make sure, even if it after putting the suturing, if it's the margins are found to be inverted, just using the forceps, just avert the margins. Margins should be always averted. Okay. Coming to the various suturing techniques, they can be broadly classified into interrupted sutures, continuous sutures, mattress sutures, or it could be some special varieties like figure of eight suture or purse string suture, or a very fancy subcuticular suture. Coming to the interrupted suture, here these are the simple sutures. In this fashion, intermittently with regular intervals of gaps, it's done. It's very simple to do, performed especially in emergency situations, and it's very easy to remove also. But the problem is, it's fails to bring all surface in contact. We saw there only after each some interval or gaps we put the suture. So in between, some amount of space or surface may be left behind to approximate. And so it is less supportive for healing. This is the pictorial representation of interrupted suturing. The technique we will learn soon. It can be continuous sutures. Simple continuous sutures. If the same thing is locked, it's called locking continuous sutures. If you do in two layers, from proximal to distal and coming back from distal to proximal, especially seen in the bladder closure and all, it could be continuous over and over suturing. This is how the starting is the same. First intermittent bite we take and put a knot, and then instead of cutting the end, we continuously take the bite to complete the wound suturing, and finally we put a square knot and end the suturing. While taking the next bite, if the needle comes through the previous loop, then the suture gets locked. Then it's called locking continuous sutures. It has got its own merits and demerits, both the variety of continuous suturing. See, if the middle one gets broken, means the entire things will give away. So intermittent has that, not that issue. In the intermittent sutures, there is some space in between for the collection to come out, any pus formed or seroma formed. But in continuous, there will not so. So and but it's very easy and very quickly you can put, but not preferred over the intermittent one. The best is the mattress sutures. It can be either a horizontal mattress or vertical mattress. Horizontal is very much similar to our intermittent simple sutures. In a way different, that we put it in a two rows. That is, first we take the bite from right to left, and instead of cutting finishing there, we come once again from left to right with some little gap in between, and then we'll tie a knot. This is called horizontal mattress. This is and another variety is vertical mattress, in which we take a bite from a far away from the wound margin, and we take another bite on the other side far away from the wound margin, and then in a return manner we take two close bites, that is far to far, and then in return near to near. near the skin margins, and then we tie a knot. This is just a theory. Don't worry if you don't understand. When we demonstrate, it will be very clear, and we will definitely make you also do the same. This is a special variety. It's figure of 8 sutures. What we do here is first take a simple bite, and then again do the same thing over it. Especially used for ligating a vessel and all. If a bleeding vessel is there, we do put a figure of 8 suture, more secure than a simple suture to tie the knot. That's figure of 8. When we two loops are formed and then we tie a knot, that is formed like two loops are formed like this. It's seen as the shape of 8. So it's called figure of 8 suture. Then comes to the purse string suturing. This is mainly useful to put some cannulas or to fix something. Okay, for example, in your internship or during residency, you may be asked to put a intercostal drainage for pleural effusion or some hemothorax. That time you make a opening in safe triangle of safety and then insert the chest tube. Then you secure it or fix it with a purse string suture. Okay, all around the your drain, you put a suture in the fashion we have seen here, and then tie a knot. Okay, so that what happens now, it will be secured, the tube is secured there, and after some days you will remove the tube and then you just tighten this purse string so that the wound is approximated. You need not again put some suturing there. That's advantage. Another example, I should say, in our cardiac surgery, to go to bypass machine, okay, we do aortic cannulation to bypass the heart and to connect it to the aorta to the bypass machine. So we do make a opening in the aorta and put a aortic cannula inside, and we fix it using a purse string suture. After the operation, we remove the aortic cannula and just tighten the purse string so that whatever the wound is there, it will get approximated there. Okay, hope it's clear. Then coming to this most cosmetic or the fancied suturing, that is subcuticular suturing. See, as we seen below, the suture is not seen only after the suturing. The wound is so nicely approximated, but the suture is inside. It's not seen. So this is just put in a subcuticular fashion. How to do that, we'll discuss and demonstrate. Some of the common mistakes as beginners we do, that is, as we can see here in the picture, too closely put and too tightly put sutures. Okay, see, this has caused ischemia and strangulation and see this erythema of the wound and all. So to prevent that, keep enough distance in between and just approximate. Don't put too tightly. And another mistake what we do is leaving dead space behind. The bite should be not very superficial. Okay, it should go deep enough to cover the entire wound depth. Okay, then there is no formation of dead space and collection of blood or serous fluid. After suturing, certain days of gap is given depending on the different part of the body. For example, for skull or head, we give about 7 to 10 days gap. For face, 5 days. For abdomen, 7 days. For joints, 10 days. For secondary suturing, 14 days. Like that, for different areas or different suturing, different time period is there. After that, we should remove these non-absorbables or the surface suturings are there. You have to remove that. To remove that also, there is a particular technique. Okay, just using a forceps, we should lift the knot or one end of the suture, and then the when the suture is lifted up, then using a normal scissor, that is our Mayo scissor or any scissor, we can cut the one end of the suture. That's the one way. That's there is a specialized scissor available for suture cutting. That's called Heath's. It has got a convex curvature so that it easily passes through the suture, and it can be easily cut even without the help of forceps. If nothing is available, no suture is available, then just ask for a 11 number blade. Okay, that pointed tip, you can just go through the inside the knot and just cut it so that the entire thing will come out intact. This is one of the common mistakes we do while removing the sutures. That is, instead of one end, we cut both the ends. We lift up the suture and we cut the both the ends of the suture. Then what happens? Only the upper part is comes out. The lower end, the inside part is left behind the body, so that it can form, it can cause infection because of foreign body reaction, or it can cause some foreign body granuloma and other things. Some of the common complications we see after suturing, sutural abscess. Yeah, as you all know, it's done, if it's done with a very unsterile manner, without taking any precautions, then it can cause infection and cause abscess. We may have to open up the wound again to drain out the pus and all. It's very cumbersome. So always take sterile precautions while doing any suturing. Second thing is hypertrophic scar formation, depending on our body nature. Some people may have this hypertrophic scar, but it's self-limiting. After 6 months or so, it regresses on its own. But in some people, the abnormal collagen deposition can cause keloid formation. See, it looks very ugly, but then it has got a treatment, like you can give steroids, you can excise, although recurrence rate is very high. This is again another complication commonly encountered. And another thing is foreign body granuloma can be formed. Now, some of the alternatives for suturing, the staples, has revolutionized the surgery field nowadays. Even the bowel anastomosis and many pexes like hemorrhoidopexy, diverticulopexies, most of things done with precision and accuracy using surgical staples like this. Many staples are available. Okay, this is skin stapler, not the for bowel and all. It's a skin stapler. Just like a paper stapler, we can put it over the skin and it will use for approximation of the wounds. And there is a separate staple remover available. You can use that to remove staples, or just with the needle holder also we can remove, or with the two artery forceps, using artery forceps also we can remove these staples very easily. It is very convenient, very quickly it can be done. In 1 or 2 minutes we can see that big wound can be covered using staples. Other thing is cyanoacrylate glue that used as tissue adhesive. Apply the adhesive glue and just close the wound. It will act as a closure technique. Another thing is some tapes are available. Like you put a plaster above the wound and then there are zips are there along with the tape. If you just pull that, it will approximate and tightly hold the wound approximated. After the wound heals, you can remove these tapes. Yeah, even after everything we do, there are sometimes inevitably some scar, big scars can be formed, ugly scars. But these patients are very clever. They always find some routes to get rid of these things. One of the best methods and beautiful methods is tattooing. See, such a bad, ugly upper abdominal scar. A patient went to a tattoo artist and got a beautiful tattooing done. Those who are interested, please take the proper guidance and pursue this beautiful branch of sacred surgery and become the best surgeons. And always, I say, skilled surgeon will make the safe surgery. So it's very essential to learn all these basic skills of surgery to become the best surgeon. This is just a brief video about suture materials and suturing techniques as a introductory way or and a prerequisite for upcoming practical session. To know in depth about the history of the suturing, sutures are manufactured, detailed classifications and suturing techniques, even the laparoscopic suturing, knotting, everything with video demonstrations. It's given in our SRB Shriram Bhatsar's book, that is SRB's Atlas of Tissue Approximation with Suturing and Knotting. It can be bought either from a JP website or in online, it's available. I have this book, very, very useful book, and especially for surgery residents. Yeah. I love suturing. I am always very fascinated to suturing from the beginning of my undergraduate days. So, but I always wanted to teach my juniors also the proper methods of suturing. But I can't show it on a patient in my while doing surgery and all. It is not so ethical. So then it's not so good to demonstrate on the like apples, banana, oranges, etc. On the sponge, etc. It is not so real. So in then I searched in the online and I got this ready-made suture practice kit. In our time when I did my UG or PG days, I didn't know about all these things and I was not aware. But glad in online I could find this and some Opsis surgical kit I ordered and I got it recently. I tried all this. It's really simulates the real body, this thing with the three layers, skin, fat and the muscle layers included in that. So now a variety of wounds are also given on this, so we can practice all kinds of suturing on this. I'll be demonstrating on Sunday. I recommend all the undergraduates, interns and the PGs to have any suture practicing kit like this, because some experiments, some modifications, some innovations we can't do directly on the patients. Instead, if we learn in these suturing kits, then we can confidently we can do on the patients. And when I got this suturing kit, I found that it is from our own India, that too from Kerala. I directly called them and told about our upcoming session, and also told we have a huge community of medical students. They all require your suturing pads. It will be very helpful for them. Please give them in a reasonable price and make it available easily. They readily agreed, and they have given us a coupon code that is White Army in capital letters without space. If you type it in their website while ordering, you will get it costs around 2,500 rupees for a large kit. You get 150 rupees of cash discount, and you'll get a customized kit. In the original kit, you'll get a silk suture like this in the reel, like this what's shown in this thing. But for you, for White Army members, you'll get 4 pre-packed sutures like this, which will be like real sutures only. So 4 extra sutures you'll get, and also the shipping will be free for you. Otherwise, they charge for shipping. So one suture is around 150 rupees. So so 600 rupees benefit there, 150 rupees of concession, so 750, and 150 rupees of shipping, so around 900 rupees you'll be saving. But and I'm not advertising or promoting anyone, but I feel as a surgeon it's essential for practicing on real simulators like this. Yeah, and welcome you all for the upcoming session of surgical skills. Whatever we discussed today, see, these are all the theoretical aspects. We can't keep discussing while doing the demonstration. So I thought we'll have a pre-recorded video on this. On the Sunday, we'll be directly demonstrating all the how we really do. Now, many videos are available, many sessions are done, but only suturing techniques are done, taught in that. Only how to do the simple suturing, how to do mattress, everything is taught. But in the real practice, when you go to a minor OT to do a suturing, you'll be fully confused or in commotion because you don't know how to start, where to start. Sisters will give some gloves, you don't know how to wear it, and you don't know how to give anesthesia, you'll be dependent on some seniors also. So we thought of doing some comprehensive session where we do how we really do, starting from the shifting the patient to the OT table, to how to clean the wound, how to drape the wound, how to wear the gloves, and how to give anesthesia, and various techniques of suturing depending on the various different conditions. I'll also show you, demonstrate you how to put staples, because that will be the future, and how to remove them. And I'll also give some tips from the beginning, because you should learn in a very proper and standard manner, because once if you learn the wrong things, undoing them and relearning would be very difficult. So from the beginning, we should learn in a proper way. So I dedicate this session and video to my great teachers who taught me the basic skills of surgery, and also those pioneer surgeons who did who invented these varieties of suturing materials and suturing techniques. So this will be totally dedicated to them. And see, I am ready with all the equipments, everything. Are you ready for the session? Thank you.